Hello? Okay, next team is Team Impulse. And they'll be designing a cold glass thruster, typically used for space applications. But in this case, I've just been told that this is really a toy for Professor Brenda. She's excited. So it will be used in the propulsion classes, and also as a demonstration, because it's a tabletop. It's not going to space. So I'm going to hand you
to Eric.
Thank you, Dr. RJ. Good afternoon, everybody. We're Team Impulse, and here's our preliminary design for our cold gas thruster. I'm Eric Trevena. This is Siobhan Gakiri, Michael Kalivas, Tyler Green, Parker Duncan, Sarah Bramlett, and Matt Andrews. We're going to start with a quick overview of our presentation. First, we're going to talk about what a cold gas thruster is. Then we're going to talk about our specific requirements for ours and our design choices to fit those requirements. Then we're going to move on to our budget and team hours, and we're going to finish off with our conclusions, recommendations, and acknowledgments. So as Dr. Akçay mentioned, a cold gas thruster is generally used in space applications. It accelerates a compressed inert gas through a nozzle to produce force. The force produced by cold gas thrusters is not generally as much as other forms of propellant, such as a monopropellant. But when you're in space conditions, you only need a small amount of force to make attitude adjustments to your space system. Seen on the right is a triad thruster, which produces 2 pounds of force. And seen on the left is our current design for our cold gas thruster. As you can see, the triad thruster is smaller than ours, but that's because we plan to produce more thrust than the triad thruster, and because the triad thruster was designed to fit certain size requirements so that it can be set on a space system. As opposed to being sent to space, our cold gas thruster will be used here by the College of Engineering for demonstrations and lab courses. We would like to see it implemented into the thermal fluids lab course for two main reasons. It will be able to teach students about instrumentation and using LabVIEW to get certain measurements, and because we plan to build our thruster with a modular design, so students will be able to change out parts of our thruster and implement their own parts and see how their designs change the effects of the thruster. Our design requirements for our thruster were that the nozzle had to be designed to produce 5 to 10 pounds of thrust in vacuum conditions, but we had to also be able to test it here in Prescott at atmosphere. We also need to be able to run in two cases. The first case is a steady state run for 5 seconds, which produces an average thrust of 5 to 10 pounds force. And the second case is a 5 hertz pulsed run, which needs to produce a maximum force of 5 to 10 pounds. We also need to be able to collect data throughout our device and display that to the user through a plug and play data acquisition system. The user needs to also be able to control the cold gas thruster through the same system that supplies the data acquisition. And we need to build an appropriate test stand which will house our thruster as well as allow for the necessary instrumentation. By the end of detail, we will produce a fully functioning cold gas thruster and a test stand which houses it and allows for instrumentation. We will include a complete drawing package of our design along with multiple recorded tests and a data acquisition software which students will be able to use for our thruster. And we'll also provide a safety and operations manual which will guide students through the use of our cold gas thruster. Seen above is a breakdown of our three main physical systems of our thruster. Highlighted in green is our plumbing system, which controls the nitrogen flow to the nozzle, and which is where we're going to be controlling our 5 hertz pulse. Highlighted in blue is our nozzle design, which will accelerate the flow and produce the force that we need from our thruster. And highlighted in gold is our test stand, which will support the thruster and allow for instrumentation of our system. Our cold gas thruster will be using compressed nitrogen as the form of propellant. It is designed for an operating pressure in vacuum conditions of 80 psi, but we'll be running it at 120 psi in atmosphere. The temperatures that we expect to see on our cold gas thruster our 440 degrees Rankine at the throat of our nozzle, and by the exit of our nozzle, we expect it to be down to 154 degrees Rankine. And as a total, we expect our design to produce 10.3 pounds force of thrust. Now I'll pass it to Siobhan to talk about the plumbing system.
Thank you, Eric. I'll be talking to you about the plumbing system of our cold gas thruster, which is highlighted in green, as you can see. When we were designing the plumbing system of our cold gas thruster, we wanted the distance between the parts to be as small as possible in order for us to minimize the amounts of pressure loss that we will have when the thrust is running. We also decided to have valves before the solenoid. We chose to have the pressure relief valve and the manual shutoff valve before the solenoid for safety purposes. We designed the plumbing system with modularity in mind. Everything is held together by standard piping, and everything is held together by threading. This makes it easy for us and for the next user to be able to change any component of the plumbing system at ease. At the end of the plumbing system, we have a flange, and that's where the nozzle will be attached. This flange design allows us to be able to change the nozzle easily, and allows the next user to be able to change the nozzle easily and test different types of nozzles and see what kind of measurements they were taking. We chose to use stainless steel for the piping and fittings of our plumbing system. The reason why we chose to use stainless steel is because stainless steel will handle the temperature and pressure that our plumbing system will be operating at. Also, based on our hoop stress analysis calculation, when our plumbing system has 120 psi flowing through, the maximum stress that will be placed on the stainless steel pipes is 88 psi. And these stainless steel pipes have a yield stress of 31,200 psi. So this gives us a factor of safety of 345, and that shows that stainless steel was the best material for us to use for the plumbing system. The pipe sizing for our plumbing system is half inch, and we'll be using half inch because half inch will be enough for, will give us enough mass flow rate that we need in order for us to be able to meet our thrust and pulsing requirement. And also the half inch is bigger than the throat of our nozzle, so that will prevent our flow from choking. The solenoid that we will be using is a MAC valve solenoid. It is piston driven and it is capable of pulsing at 9 Hertz. The normal position of the solenoid is normally closed, and that is a good thing in terms of safety. If there's a loss of power, the solenoid will normally close itself and prevent any excess nitrogen from flowing through. The solenoid was designed for pneumatic operation, so we will be using a second regulator to run compressed air through the pneumatic port of the solenoid, and that will power the solenoid and help increase the response time to 11 milliseconds. For plumbing safety, we will have the manual shutoff valve and the pressure relief valve. If the pressure of our plumbing system exceeds 150 psi, the pressure relief valve will activate and release any excess pressure. And in case of a malfunction, we will be able to manually cut off the flow of nitrogen gas by using the manual shutoff valve. So this shows that we have full control of the nitrogen gas at all times when the thrust is running. We will be using nitrogen gas as the primary propellant. The reason is because the nitrogen gas is inexpensive, and for our operating pressure of 120 psi, we will have an ISP of 68.65. The tank will be provided to us by the College of Engineering. The tank has a volume of 60 cubic feet, and it will be pressurized at 1500 psi, and that will give us a maximum runtime of 300 seconds. This picture here shows our gas connections. Highlighted in blue is a 3-foot hose that we will use to connect the nitrogen tank at the beginning of the plumbing system. And highlighted in green is the second regulator and the 2-foot hose that we will use to run compressed air to power our solenoid. When the plumbing system, when the cold gas thruster is running, we are expecting to have pressure losses. This picture here shows the location and the amount of pressure loss that we're expecting to have, which total to 17 psi. And in order for us to maintain our chamber design of what our nozzle chamber pressure of 120 psi, we will regulate the amount of nitrogen gas flowing through by increasing it to 135 psi in order for us to accommodate for the pressure losses. Based on our mass flow rate calculations, we are expecting the nitrogen gas to exit the solenoid at a velocity of 172 feet per second. This means that the nitrogen gas will be traveling 17 feet between each pulse during the 5 hertz pulse run. So this shows that the chamber of our nozzle will be completely empty between each pulse. And now I will pass it on to Michael, who will talk to you about the nozzle design.
Thank you, Siobhan. So I'll be sharing with you some of the design points of our nozzle, as you can see highlighted there in blue. So for this nozzle, it's just a simple bell nozzle. It was designed using the method of characteristics, and it is designed to be machined out of aluminum, as well as attached to the rest of our plumbing system using a flange. So for this nozzle, we started with the design choices of a Mockett to the 3.5, a throat diameter of 0.348 inches, which is a standard drill bit size to make it easier for machining, as well as an ideal thrust of 12 pounds, knowing that we will get losses in our real calculations. So this yielded us an area ratio of 6.7, an exit diameter of 0.9 inches, and a real thrust of 10.3. With all this, we have an overall length of 4.43 inches, as well as a bell length of just over 2.9 inches. So what method of characteristics is a series of characteristic lines that when plotted with angles, theta wall max, and mu, they will intersect to create a bell nozzle design. So we calculated theta wall max and mu using the ratio of specific heats gamma of nitrogen, as well as we knew our exit Mach numbers, we were able to start with that. So once we had mu and theta wall max, we plotted these lines, and as those lines intersected with the theta wall max angle, we start to get a bell nozzle contour. So as you can see here, the more characteristic lines you add, the smoother and more defined bell nozzle contour you will get, and is the more recognizable bell that you see on rockets today. So the reason we went with the method of characteristics is this method provides us with a shock-free and isentropic flow, as well as it's a very repeatable process. So if we were to have to change any design parameters farther in our design process, we can create a whole new nozzle with very little time loss. So knowing that our nozzle will reach very low temperatures, as low as 154 degrees Rankine, we needed a material that will withstand this, as well as withstand its maximum pressure of 120 psi at the throat. For this, we found 6061 aluminum. This type of aluminum maintains 10% of its yield strength at 141 degrees Rankine, and has a max yield strength of 42,000 psi. So with this, when our nozzle is being run, we will still have a factor of safety of well over 30. Now to connect our nozzle to the rest of our plumbing system, we'll have a flange machined into the nozzle. It's going to be machined out of one solid piece of stock, so there's no welding or anything that could cause deformation of our nozzle and impede our performance. As well as the flange, we also have an O-ring inserted between the two flanges so that when they're bolted together and tightened down, we have an airtight seal and no loss of pressure and no loss of performance. As well as our full-length bell nozzle, we also have a truncated nozzle. Now, because our nozzle was designed for a space application or vacuum conditions, we are expected to see some flow separation occurring in the nozzle. By our calculations, we expected to see this 0.647 inches downflow from the throat. So with this, once we attach our truncated nozzle to our plumbing system and run our tests, we should be able to see the same performance out of our truncated nozzle as well as our full-length nozzle, giving us the confirmation in our design. And now I'll pass it off to Tyler, who will talk to you about our nozzle temperature and flow analysis.
All right, thank you, Mike. Now moving on to the temperature analysis throughout our nozzle. We assumed a T ambient temperature on the outside of our nozzle, as well as an outer surface temperature, and then that goes into an inner surface throughout the contour of our nozzle, and then an inner static temperature. And we assumed that we got these temperatures by calculating with adiabatic flow equations. And then we assume constant heat transfer rates on the inside and outside of the nozzle. For the outside, we assume the constant heat convection coefficient of air just at our ambient 554 Rankine. And then on the inside, we assume the max convection coefficient of nitrogen. And this is the max force convection coefficient that we will see on the inside of the nozzle. Now this graph here shows the temperature throughout the contour of our nozzle. Each point is essentially each Mach point that we use to design this nozzle. In orange is the outside surface of our nozzle, and in blue is the inside contour. As you can see, the outside temperature is only going to vary by a few degrees, or by less than 1 degree Rankine. And the inside of the nozzle is going to start out at the 440 Rankine at the throat, and then gradually go down into our 554 Rankine at the exit. Now, because the nozzle is going to be seeing such low temperatures, we're going to need to calculate the thermal contraction due to that. And we use this by this plot shown up here, and the dotted line at the bottom for 6061 aluminum. And this plot essentially gives us a more accurate determination of our contracted nozzle length versus a linear. This gives more accurate calculations. Now this plot here shows us the results of those calculations. Shown in orange is our contracted nozzle length, and shown in blue, which is going to be underneath the orange dots, is our initial nozzle length. And as you can see, the lengths only vary by 0.01 inches, and this allows us to, or this shows that our nozzle is only going to shrink by a little bit at our lowest temperatures, and we're not going to have to worry about any connection points on there shrinking. Now moving on to computational fluid dynamics around a nozzle, we use ANSYS Fluent to do this. And essentially we use this to help us confirm that our hand calculations are indeed correct and that the contour of our nozzle is also designed correctly. And essentially what Fluent does is helps us visualize the flow, and we did this by showing the contour lines. We did this by importing a 2D geometry and then creating the high density mesh and then setting up the boundary conditions from our design points and MATLAB results to see if they match, and then getting a solution. So here's our 2D nozzle mesh setup. Essentially, the inside of the nozzle is completely black, and that is just because our mesh is very high density on the inside. Compared to the outside, you can see the boxes individually because the outside is a little less important than what's actually going on the inside contour of the nozzle. And we did this by using quadrilateral mesh, getting sizing at the edges to get it very high density, and then face meshing to get it actually into the quadrilateral versus using triangles. And this mesh resulted in a low skewness of 0.35, and essentially the lower skewness it is, the more accurate the results will be. Now for the boundary conditions, we assumed an inlet pressure of 80 psi, and because this nozzle was designed for space applications, that's why we use our 80 psi instead of 120 psi for in atmosphere. Ambient temperature of 554 Rankine, and a wall temperature of our lowest temperature that we will see is 154 Rankine. And the solver we used was pressure-based and second-order upwind, and this is essentially the most accurate model for turbulence through a supersonic nozzle. Now moving on to some of the results, here are our velocity results. We calculated an exit velocity of 2,171 feet per second, but ANSYS Fluent shows that we will be getting roughly 2,000 feet per second at our exit. For our pressure results, we calculated an exit pressure of 1 psi, and Fluent shows that we will actually have an exit pressure of 3.45 psi. For our Mach number results, these are essentially the most important since we designed the nozzle to exit at 3.5, but in here it shows that our exit Mach will actually be 2.75. And our temperature results, we calculated again to be 154 Rankine at the coldest at the exit of the nozzle, but Fluent, it shows that we'll actually be seeing 220 Rankine, which is a little bit warmer. Now what these results mean and why they differ a lot compared to our hand calculations is our hand calculations assume adiabatic and isentropic flows. They don't take into account any turbulence or viscous effects due to the flow. And essentially, Fluent calculates a real analysis and includes these. And we did this by using K epsilon model, and it's the most used for turbulent models, most used turbulent models for supersonic flow, and it results in a higher turbulence. So this might also be why we are receiving the different results, is because of the high shear stress turbulence. But the K-epsilon model does have the lowest computational needs compared to other models, which we will be looking into running through this analysis with other models and other boundary setups to see if we can get more accurate results. Now I'm gonna pass it off to Parker to talk to you about the test stand.
All right. Hey, Tom. So I'll be talking about the test stand, which is highlighted here in this photo in gold.
And so for the major test gen requirements, the first big requirement is it must allow the nozzle to move forward and backwards smoothly so that we can get accurate, consistent thrust measurements. It must also allow easy access to our thruster, and it must be simple and affordable to machine since we only have a budget of $1,000. So the design for the sliding collars, the two that you can see there highlighted in gold, one collar will hold a piece of pipe and the other collar will hold the nozzle, and the rest of the thruster assembly will be in between that. And it will utilize linear bearings to slide back and forth in unison, and this will allow us to get consistent and accurate thrust measurements. So we decided to use Simplicity linear bearings for our collars to slide on. And we chose to use Simplicity linear bearings because they provide smooth linear motion using self-lubricating technology. And they also absorb hard particles to eliminate damage to our quarter-inch rods. And they also use a ballless design so that there's no way for the balls to get gummed up or to get stuck on our rods and catastrophic fail. They also have a better price compared to quality linear bushings. Ball bushing is $21.37 each, and the linear bearings that we'll be using are only $15.60 a piece. So the thruster collars were designed with easy installation in mind so that we can take pieces out of the thruster out and put them in easily. So the bottom half will be slid onto the linear rods with linear bearings in between, and the top halves will come down and lock the piece that it's holding in place. And we also have a gasket around the inner circumference of each of the collars. And the reason that we're going to put a gasket there is so that we can reduce vibrations during testing, also compensate for thermal contraction and expansion, as well as reduce wear on parts, namely the collars and the pieces that they're holding. So we chose, for the material for the collar gaskets, we chose to use polyurethane foam. And the reason that we chose to use polyurethane foam is because it can withstand a wide range of temperatures, from negative 22 degrees Fahrenheit to 230 degrees Fahrenheit without failing or cracking. And polyurethane foam is also very wear resistant, which means that we shouldn't have to change those gaskets out very many times over the life of this thruster. The gaskets will also reduce vibrations a little bit, and polyurethane foam is very cost effective. It's only 79 cents a foot. So for the caster assembly, the casters must obviously be able to support the weight of the table with the thruster assembly on it. And so we chose to use a caster with a rubber wheel, so because the rubber wheels will be able to roll over small objects in the shop as well as move quietly. And these casters will use a ball bearing design so that they'll be able to swivel 360 degrees and allow us to move the cart in any direction necessary. And to mount the casters to the legs of the cart, we will use a mounting bracket, 6-inch by 6-inch mounting bracket with 1/4-inch holes drilled in each of the corners. And the reason that we drilled these 1/4-inch holes is to put 6-inch long 1/4-inch bolts through there so that we can not only lift the cart off the ground, the casters, as well as the cart off of the ground, this is also a way for us to help level the cart. So we performed a structural analysis on the two 1/4-inch linear rods. And the reason that we performed the structural analysis is to ensure that these 1/4-inch rods will adequately support, hold and support the weight of our thruster assembly. And so that to make sure that the 1/4-inch rods will not deflect so much that it will cause our bearings to bind up and not allow us to test our thruster properly. And so here are the results from the structural finite element analysis that we performed in ANSYS. So the maximum deflection on one of the rods with the weight of the thruster assembly on it is 1.73 times 10 to the negative 4th inches. And for a little bit of perspective, that's less than a thousandth of an inch, which is a very small amount of deflection. And the maximum stress that the weight of the thruster assembly will cause on this 1/4-inch rod is 1,264.9 psi. And the yield stress for steel is 36,000 psi. So comparing these results to that value, our rods will not even come close to yielding, and they also will not bend nearly enough to cause our bearings to bind up. And we went with the cantilever design for mounting our test stand. So we'll be mounting our test stand off the end of one side of our table. And the reason that we're doing this is because there's a hole in the side of the propulsion. And so we'll be able to put the nozzle exit of our thruster out into the open outside through that hole in the prop lab. And this will allow us to safely exit the flow out into the atmosphere, as well as allow us to visualize our flow when necessary. And now I'll pass it on to Sarah for that instrumentation.
In this image, you can see the locations we will be placing our instrumentation to take measurements. We will be taking feed pressure at our pressure relief valve, also feed pressure measurements of the feed pipe between our solenoid and nozzle, pressure and temperature measurements at the exit of our nozzle, and thrust measurements on the sliding collar attached to our thruster. Feed pressure measurements are important because they help us evaluate the flow in the nozzle. We can do this by calculating the velocity based off the total and static pressures. They also help us assess pressure losses, and we can compare those to our hand calculations. They are also essential in helping us create a plug-and-play system because our sensors direct transduce our data to a computer interface. The sensors we'll be using to collect our feed pressure are a pressure tap and a keel probe. Our pressure tap is a simple design that will measure static pressure for the low cost of $2.43. We will be machining this by drilling a hole into the feed pipe, placing a small tube purchased for about $2.50 into the hole, and applying adhesive to hold it into place. We will be using an 1/8-inch diameter keel probe to measure our total pressure, and we will be permanently placing that into the feed because to reduce breakage of the keel probe from continuous reinsertion and extraction of the probe from the feed. There's a simple process to place it in the feed. We will be drilling a hole just like in the pressure tap, placing the keel probe into the feed, aligning it with the flow, and applying adhesive to hold it into place. The alternative would have been to use a pedostatic tube. The smallest pedostatic tube has a long head length of 0.875 inches, as can be seen here, which is why we will not be using a pedostatic tube because it will be too complex to insert into the feed. Also, a keel probe is only $84 compared to a $400 pedostatic tube. We'll be using 3 pressure transducers to relay the output from our sensors to our data acquisition device. One transducer will be placed on the pressure relief valve, and 2 transducers will be connected to our keel probe and our pressure tap to relay that to our data acquisition device. All 3 of these pressure transducers will be borrowed from the College of Engineering. Our exit measurements are important because they allow us to evaluate the flow at the exit. We will be using this equation shown to determine the velocity. It's based on the static and total pressures and the static temperature. We will be able to evaluate the flow in our truncated nozzle as well as in our regular length nozzle. This also helps us create a plug-and-play system by directly relating our sensor's output to our computer interface. We will be using a pedostatic tube embedded with a K-type thermocouple to record our static and total pressures and our static temperature. Our K-type thermocouple offers us the very low range we're expecting of temperature to come out of the nozzle. This can also be borrowed from the College of Engineering. We'll be coupling that with 2 pressure transducers to relay the sensor data to an electrical output, and those devices can also be borrowed from the College of Engineering. Thrust is important to collect because we're required to output 5 to 10 pounds force of thrust. So we need the most accurate sensor that we can to get a reading that will tell us whether we are in that range, which is why we decided to use a 0 to 25 pound force load cell. As flow exits our nozzle, our thruster is pushed forward and the sliding collar in gold is compressed against our load cell in green against a wall on the test stand. Our load cell measures compression force and it senses and transduces that data in one device. It offers an accurate range for our expected 5 to 10 pounds force output, and it can be borrowed from the College of Engineering. To get the most accurate measurements possible, we decided to use a long pipe and a short pipe design. Our long pipe design will have our keel probe and our pressure tap permanently placed in the long pipe, and our short pipe design will have a shorter pipe without those devices. The short pipe will ensure that we get the most accurate thrust and exit measurements because we will not have those devices impeding the flow upstream. I'll now pass it on to Matt to talk about the control and data acquisition.
Thanks, sir.
We chose to use LabVIEW programming as the control system and data acquisition for our unit. LabVIEW is a unique program in that it is designed for control systems and data acquisition. It uses a visual interface with graphical representations as seen in the program on the right. LabVIEW also offers many pre-wired modules for easy plug-and-play connectivity with our instrumentation devices, as well as our output controls. LabVIEW is also used in at least two courses for MEs in our data acquisition course and lab thermal fluids course, so using those professors as sources of help has been really helpful this semester. This is the control and data acquisition schematic that we brought to Dr. Briner. It lays out our locations of all the measurements that we plan on taking, as well as the instruments for those locations. We work through the module library that we have on campus and pair each module up respectively with their desired instruments. These modules will then be connected through a module hub, which will relay information to and from our LabVIEW program. The LabVIEW modules that we'll be using will be a digital output module communicating between our solenoid valve. It's a digital output on a 24-volt scale, which will send high and low voltage signals to open and close our solenoid valve. The thermocouple input will operate on a millivolt range to read data from our thermocouples. Load cells and pressure transducers will operate on a 5-volt input module, respectively. The load cell was mentioned to us that it might need a little more sensitivity due to the fact that we're about half the capacity of the 25-pound force load cell. So it was looked into, and the resolution that we expect from our load cell module will be 7/1000ths of a pound force. So that will be more than enough to see the pulse output graph with enough resolution for our output. And here on the bottom is the chassis that they will all be connected to relay information to the program. It was also mentioned that we should be looking into advanced communication techniques between our modules. You can communicate between modules between two different ways, through a DAC assistant. It's a basic menu-based function as seen on the top right, and it has limited kind of user interface as to how to control the devices. DAC MX code, however, on the bottom is comprised of the same things in the menu itself. However, it allows for more customization and control. So using the advantage of using the code would be for using it to internally clock the output to our solenoid valve and such. The digital output to our solenoid valve will run on two cases. For our 5-second steady state run, it'll be on a continuous duty cycle of 100%, meaning that the solenoid valve will receive a high voltage signal at the start of the run, and that will remain high for the remainder. And on a second case, where the solenoid valve will be on a 5 Hz pulsed run on a 50% duty cycle, meaning it will receive high and low voltage signals for 50% of the test. The safety measures that we've included in our instrumentation will be an inline fuse between the digital output module and the solenoid valve. That fuse will prevent against any surges that may happen in the system, as well as a manual power disconnect that, since our solenoid operates on a normally closed bias, if the power is disconnected from the solenoid, it will close and secure our system. Now I'll pass it on to Eric to talk about our budget and team options.
Thank you, Matt. This table represents the current budget breakdown for Team Impulse. All of the prices in this table are accurate prices based on parts which the team has selected to order for our cold gas thruster. Every piece that the team also believes that we're going to need to order to build our cold gas thruster is represented in this table, which provides us with a total of $870. Now, out of our total $1,000 budget, this leaves us with $130 of surplus, which will be able to be put towards future expenses as they arise. This is a breakdown of the team's hours. The blue is the team's projected hours based on 2 hours of work outside of class for every hour of work inside of class per team member. The highlighted in orange is the team's hours worked outside of class. The team's hours outside of class are lower than the projected hours. However, the team has worked efficiently and effectively when we do put in our hours and has still been able to produce a cold gas thruster design even though we did not meet the projected hours. Conclusions and recommendations for our thruster. We will be using a modular design, which will allow for us to change the thruster as well as future students who want to run their own tests. We'll be using a bell nozzle to accelerate our nitrogen flow and produce our force output. We'll be using a test stand, which will house our thruster and allow for linear movement so that a load cell can measure the compressive force of our thruster. We'll also be using a pressure tap and a keel probe at the entrance of the nozzle to make our total and static feed pressure measurements. And we'll use a pedostatic tube with an embedded thermocouple at the exit of our nozzle to make our total and static pressure as well as our static temperature measurements. All these measurements will be passed in the lab view, which will provide the user with a graphical interface and which will also be used to control our cold gas thruster. The next step in our design process will be bringing our nozzle and our test stand design to the manufacturing review board. Upon their approval of our design, Team Impulse will order our parts and begin manufacturing and building our cold gas thruster and running tests on it. Team Impulse would like to thank the College of Engineering for providing us with instrumentation devices, which total over $5,000 worth of devices, as well as supplying us with facilities to build and test our cold gas thruster. Team Impulse would also like to thank Kurt Gijoa Inc. for providing us with our solenoid, our second regulator, and our pressure hose, which will be used in our system. Thank you. Are there any questions?
Good job, guys. That was really good. Good
thank
detail.
You.
You start at the beginning. Slide six. Define plug and play.
So our plug and play design is so that students don't need to take a lot of time wiring their own instrumentation devices in and hooking those up to LabVIEW. We want to create a system where there's a preset LabVIEW software so that students will be able to simply plug the devices into the modules that we tell them to plug into, and it'll be able to run the system for them.
Okay. Let's see. And then for your nozzle fabrication, did I understand it to be that you were going to machine the flange and the nozzle out of one solid piece of aluminum?
Yes, that's the current design for the nozzle.
Okay, so there's going to be 3.5-inch piece of aluminum stock that you hog out, all that.
Yes.
Okay. And you decided that was better than the welding on the...
We decided that was better than a flange because we were able to find a big enough piece of aluminum stock that it was actually cheaper to do this than buying a flange for both our nozzle design and our truncated nozzle. And we didn't want to risk having any deformation of our nozzle when we try and weld it.
Slide 30. Do you really need to have it out to the thousandth place there on your temperature and length? Because the accuracy of the thermocouple is like plus or minus 1°C.
The graph doesn't need to be out to the thousandth.
Okay.
Let's
check what it is. All right. Okay. You guys need to print your slide numbers bigger. 34. All right, Tyler, you and I have talked about this a little bit, that your model mesh for boundary layer inflation, have you looked any further into that?
I have looked into it, but since we got together earlier this week and in preparation for this and finals, I've not been able to get deeper into it.
Right.
But over the winter break, I'm going to be able to look at it and try and get more accurate.
Yeah, because I think one of the things from this CFD modeling here is if you go to slide, I guess it would be 36. So from your velocity there, it does look like you have the boundary layer there from the the top near the wall of the nozzle. It looks like it's something you probably need to resolve a little bit more. And that could help you with your exit velocity Mach number calculations. And you might need to redesign your straining section of your nozzle a little bit to account for that. It's pretty common. The previous slide, I had a question as to why you used, and maybe I misunderstood this, the inlet pressure of 80 psi was supposed to be for space?
Yes, so.
But the outside ambient temperature, is space gonna be 554 degrees Rankine? Does that sound like those two boundary conditions don't match up?
So it was run for in vacuum conditions essentially. It doesn't mean that it has to be in space. Like if you can put this in a vacuum chamber and the ambient temperature is still gonna be that, then we can use the 80 psi and 154. But that was just the initial running. I was going to also attempt to do one at a lower temperature of cold temperature of space and then hot side.
All right, I'm gonna stop picking on the tire, even though I could go on for a while. All right, let's see, slide 47. The 6.16 inch screws you said for leveling, mm-hmm. and for also keeping
it from, lifting it up off the ground.
And keeping it from moving. So those jacking screws, kind of like four of them or three of them on each, that seems kind of tedious. Is there another?
I mean, I use this design on a loading cable at home. It weighs like 150 pounds, and it works fairly well.
But to level, oh, sorry, go ahead, Eric.
This was our initial design. The casters haven't been as crucial of a part as other systems in our cold gas thruster, so this is our initial design of it, but because placing 16, or leveling 16 screws would be tedious, and each screw is just over $8. So 16 of those has taken up a large chunk of our budget, so the team does plan to reevaluate the leveling plan.
We could use that same design with just like one bolt that's like 5/8 inch or 3/4 inch, yeah. And it'll do the same job.
Yeah, this just seems like it. I'm too lazy to do that.
I see what you're saying.
All right, slide 56. That's slide 85. Slide 56. So first of all, I thought the instrumentation part was the best part because Sarah is a great teacher and mentor. So my comment here is that the pressure transducers, the fact that you think they're $150 each, that's cute. Anyway, I think that might be it for me. Yes. All right. Good job, guys.
Thank you. You've
done a good job.
All right. Starting back at the beginning, just general plumbing system 12. Just the modularity function of all this. I didn't quite understand. What do you anticipate changing out other than the nozzle itself?
In this design, there's not much to change out. In a previous iteration of our design, we had a pressure chamber that was in our design. That was something more that we were thinking maybe students would want to see how it's run with the pressure chamber, how it's run without it. But our pressure chamber was taken out because once calculations were performed, it really wasn't doing anything for our system. But the modular design would allow students to try and maybe add something like that to their design.
Okay, but as of now, the only thing anticipated is possibly different nozzles.
Yes.
Okay. And then on that pressure relief valve, where's that going?
The pressure relief valve is on the top where you see the T.
Where's the outlet going?
It goes, I believe the pressure relief valve, it goes up.
Because it looks like you were showing mounting a pressure transducer on the top of it.
I'm not sure exactly where the pressure transducer would be mounted and where the pressure relief.
Okay, just something to think about with personnel operating.
Okay.
I got one question, one comment. Question is, can you comment on the response times of the solenoid, the pressure transfer, the force sensor, and the kinematics of the system, and the dynamics of the system, to say, so you can detect the 5 Hertz pulse.
Matt's done a lot. He knows about the sensitivity of the load cell and the solenoid, so I'm going to pass that to him.
The load cell's rated with a response time, just generalized, but sort of response time of 11 milliseconds on a DC input. Whether that's energizing the solenoid valve or actual operation of the valve itself, we're not quite sure. We'll have to test that and figure out what that thrust output looks like. As far as reading, with calculating that resolution of the load cell itself at like 7/1000ths of a pound, we're not worried in that respect. However, with keeping up with the hertz, the pulsing part of it, we'll have to test the system itself and see what that would be.
So you understand resolution is very different from response time?
Yeah. The response time of the load cell itself, I don't know that value off the top of my
head. And then also there's inertia in the new structure as well.
We're expecting, like, we're planning on putting the sliding collar as close to the load cell as possible before the testing to reduce that first initial jolt. But there's still probably going to be a little bit of a jolt, and then we'll see it kind of level out as the stress does.
And then just a comment, following up on Dr. Breiner's comment about the plugging it all up on the new piece of aluminum. I'll make this question here. The question is, did you consider the cost of the machining?
The cost of the machining has that wasn't taken into consideration.
Or any.
This.
You really should think about welding it or even threading it into the flange. And if you're worried about the distortion after the welding, you can weld it before you do the flange.
Okay.
Did you guys run the truncated nozzle in CFD yet? Or did you, you said you were going to prepare that, and so I wondered if you've done any counts on that yet?
We haven't yet run that in CFD.
Okay. Do you know what the response time is for your thermocouple when your total runs at 5 Hertz or your other runs about 5 seconds? How long does it take to get down to the 154 or the 200 Rankine?
I'm going to pass that off to Sarah.
We do not know
that. Watch out. Yeah, that's why I'm asking. All right. Otherwise, it was a good job. Thanks.
All right, really good presentation. I haven't seen cold gas thrush in a long time. Can you go slide 4? So just something that would help me a little bit, maybe a quick pros and cons of the cold gas, like maybe to model propeller or something, just a little more background, because like I said, I haven't seen these in a long time, so I'm sitting here thinking, what was the cold gas again? Studied in school.
Okay.
Slide 13. Okay, so you're going to throw all these together, you're going to be put the fluid through it. What's sealing it?
We're going to be getting Teflon. We're going to be adding Teflon tape around the thread.
Okay. Can that tape withstand the temperatures you're putting through it?
We haven't run an analysis on that. Okay. However, we're not expecting the majority of our extreme cold temperatures happen after the throat of the nozzle.
Okay.
It'll drop in temperature through the plumbing system, but not too cold.
Okay, I just want to make sure you don't get embrittlement or anything like that. Go to slide 22. Not to jump on the nozzle bandwagon as well, but does the outside need to be machined? I mean, might save you some time, just a thought. Slide 27. So you're sealing this. So how are you gonna make sure that your seal is good? How are you gonna make sure you get enough squeeze? Are you torquing screws? Are you using a specific kind of O-ring? How are you making sure you have a good seal?
That hasn't been something that's been thought of quite yet.
The current
plan is just tighten it up really good.
Okay. I just asked because I want to make sure you guys are thinking about this. Find appropriate torque values. Make sure you get the right amount of squeeze, because
That's a really awkward place to be a lead. 37. So I can't quite read this, so if you could help me out, what is the very top pressure? I just can't read it.
1.05 psi.
I mean in the red.
It looks like
5.37 times 10 to the fifth.
If I can add on to that. So Fluent runs it in SI units, and I just converted to standard English units. And I just realized that you can change the units in ANSYS this week. So
okay,
you get the chance to update the models.
Okay, no worries. Because I was looking at that number just thinking, that's high. That's really high. Yeah, it'd just be nice to know what that is in PSI, because like I said, I was looking at that just thinking, I don't think it's really that high, but that's scary. And last one, 5.4, I know it's kind of a tired message now, but how are you going to make sure that the adhesive you use for your sensors keeps it sealed?
That's something we still have to look into.
It's the same drum, it's just a, watch these things because they can sneak up on you and they can ruin your parts. Those little details that will just kill you, and it can take weeks to solve it, because that's what happened to us. So just want to make sure you're thinking about it, just want to make sure you're aware of them.
Thank you.
Because overall, it's a good presentation, it's a really good start, lots of details to still be explored, and it looks like it'll be fun. It'll be a great tour, right?
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.